Welcome to this NPTEL course on muffler acoustics. So we are in the week 11 of this course, and for the first time in this course, although quite late, we'll be introducing the three-dimensional analytical solution of muffler systems. So we'll begin with your rectangular chambers, but and different ways how to characterize such a chamber. You know, there are different ways, like solving a homogeneous set of equations subjected to inhomogeneous boundary conditions, or the other way around, where we characterize the system by solving inhomogeneous system equations subjected to homogeneous boundary conditions by means of Green's function, and then using it further to derive the uniform piston driven model approximation. So there are number of things, number of ways in which we will analyze these things. But before we do that, the way we are going to characterize this system is using your impedance matrix things, which is basically nothing but the transfer function. So let's say you have a it's an arbitrary muffler, and you have, say, the first port 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and say 6. Okay, let's say we have 6 ports. It could be actually, let instead of calling it like 5 or 6, I would say that n minus 1 nth port. So how do you characterize such a system? So if we recall our discussions that we had in the, week 9 later parts, or week 10, the initial parts, you will see that, an impedance matrix is the best way to characterize such a system. So I'm dropping the tildes, excuse me for that. So here you have this kind of a thing, so we get this is such a matrix. So what is that matrix called? Where we relate pressure to the acoustic mass velocities at the different ports, such a matrix is called an impedance matrix. So how do you write this? So it's basically, Z11, Z12, Z1n, Z21, Z22, Z2n, Z31, Z32, like this, Zn1, Znn, and Z3n. So this is a n cross n system. So how do you get the different parameters for that? Let's go back to our schematic or the line diagram. So what we do, let's say we excite the system, by means of some kind of a piston excitation somewhere here, to and fro motion. We generate waves, we block all the ports here, or you could also block it, elsewhere, so that the effect of sudden expansions at these ports might also come into effect. But for argument's sake, let's say we want the characterization right from the interface. So we'll move this piston somewhere here and excite it right at the port chamber interface. Okay, so when we excite with a uniform velocity or certain velocity and block all the ports, so what do we get? The mass velocity is, V2, V3, all the things, Vn is 0. Under such a thing, what will all these things become? P1 is equal to Z11 times V1, Z12 times V2, and so on. So let me expand this guy out. P1 is equal to Z11 times V1, Z12 times V2, Z13 times V3, and Z1n times Vn. But then all these things are 0. Why? Because you have blocked all the ports. You have, covered with the rigid surface. So the acoustic velocity normal to the surface is necessarily 0. So you get P1 by V1 is equal to Z11. You get this kind of a thing. Okay. So similarly, now if you were to have a mount a sensor here, now put the sensor here, P2. So P2 by V1 will get you Z21. P3 by V1 will get you Z31, because all the other components, we can write down this entire equation like this, all these things are 0. So Pn by V1 is equal to Zn1. So, you know, like this, if we block all the other ports, you know, all the other ports are blocked and only the first excitation only at the first port is there, then this entire thing, you will get the first column. Similarly, if you block the second port, I'm sorry, excite at the second port and block the ports 1 to 1 and 3 to n, you know, you will get basically the second row, second column, I'm sorry. Like this, you could traverse the entire thing and characterize the system using n cross n thing. You know, it's very similar, you know, P1 by V1 or P2 by V1, these are very similar to your transfer functions, acoustic transfer function, which a lot of authors prefer to call them. In a sense, impedance matrix parameters or acoustic transfer functions are one and the same only. They have been used interchangeably in many papers, but they are one and the same. And using these transfer functions or the impedance matrix parameters, one can also obtain the transfer matrix parameters or the four pole parameters. We will see soon, but what we will do in this lecture, you know, because we are going to use the impedance matrix formulation to characterize you know, a rectangular chamber and a circular chamber in this course, and I might just talk about little bit about elliptical mufflers using analytical functions, just a glimpse of that. But perhaps, you know, an impedance matrix kind of a thing would be very much suited for analysis of such reactive chamber mufflers. And before we do that, let me sort of more firmly establish this theory, which I am in the process of course, and also talk about how do you obtain, finally we need to obtain the transmission law. So, how do you obtain that, and you know, how do you you know, get different conditions in which transmission laws goes to shows a peak or shows a trough, much like your transfer matrix T matrix parameter. So we have basically your P is equal to Z V, this is n cross n. So, we would want such a thing here, A1 P1, A2 B2, A3 B3. So, what are these? You know, A1 is the wave that is incident here, B1 is the one that goes here. Similarly, A2 is here, B2 is here, AN goes here, BN goes here. So, basically what we can do, you know, we can write the entire this column as A1 plus B1, A2 plus B2, A3 plus B3 and AN and PN. Okay, we can do that, and this is your Z11, Z12 and Z1N, and this will become your Zn1 and Znn, and you know, you will get your, and mass velocities, mind you, you know, going back to the definition, A1 minus B1, A2 minus B2 by Y2 and An minus Bn by Yn. So, Yis are the characteristic impedance of the ports. So, so you know, you get this sort of a thing. So, now what we do is basically A1 plus B1, A2 plus B2 and An and Bn is equal to Z times 1 by Y, where Y is also n cross n, and this is also n cross n, and this becomes A1 minus B1, A2 minus B2 and An minus Bn. Okay. So, your Y is the diagonal matrix, you know, I would write this as a diagonal n cross n, and you know, so what will happen here is that A1 plus B1, like this you get An plus Bn will be Z11 times, this will become your Z11 times Y1, because you remember, so the each of these terms will be multiplied, you can consider this Z11 multiplied by Y11, I am sorry, Z12 multiplied by Y2 and so on. So, So basically what will happen is that this will become Z13. And Z21 will be multiplied by Y1. So here you will have Z21, Z22, Y2, Z23, Y3, Z2n times Yn, Zn1 times Y1, Zn2 times Y2, Zn3 times Y3, Zn n times Yn. Okay. So this will become A1 minus B1, A2 minus B2, and this will become An minus Pn. Okay. So we are in the process of obtaining what is known as a scattering matrix parameter. So basically, scattering matrix. Eventually, you might be wondering what exactly we are trying to do here. We are trying to relate the reflected wave amplitudes bi's, that is b1, b2, b3, bn, in terms of the incident wave amplitudes a1, a1, a2, a3, and so on, an. So you know, this is now it becomes rather simple. What we now basically do is that rearrange a few terms. So what we can do from here is that arrange terms like b1, b2, bn. This can be rearranged as C inverse T, and this is nothing but A1, A2, An. So what exactly is C and D matrix? So C matrix is nothing. It does involve a little bit of algebra, so I would request all of you guys to please do the longhand derivation and practice it by yourself. So this is nothing but Z11 by Y1 plus 1, Z22 by Y2 plus 1, and this is Znn by Yn plus 1. So what about the other terms? You know, it's Z12 by Y2, and we get Z1n by Yn, and Zn1 by Y1, and this is like this. So like this one can populate the entire thing to get the C matrix. So last term will be Zn minus 1 and like this, and your D matrix is nothing but you will pretty much get the same thing, but instead of a plus sign you will have a minus sign. So everything else will be the same, and here we will have Z22 Y2 minus 1 like this. And this will be your Yn, and this will be your Zn plus 1 Y1. So C and D. So basically we get C inverse D, and this is CD. So you know, this can be written in a much more compact manner, where you know your B vector, I would say B vector, or the vector of the reflected wave amplitude. So let me sort of write it down in the full blown out form itself: B1, B2, B3, Bn is equal to, this is equal to S matrix, but this can be written in the form of Z matrix, and Y, which you should remember, this is a diagonal matrix. So Y inverse will be Y is a diagonal matrix, so it's Y1, Y2, Y3, Yn all on the diagonals, everything else is 0. So Y inverse, if you do, you just have to take the inverse of the diagonal element. So this will be plus I. So this is a much more compact way of writing stuff, and Z Y inverse minus I times A1, A2, A3, AN. So like this we can keep doing, and you know there is yet another well perhaps a little bit more compact way of doing this thing is that, you know, if you realize this that you know instead of minus I if you write plus I then you have to subtract minus 2 I. Okay, so once you multiply this guy with this z y inverse plus I whole inverse with this particular thing, you will get I matrix, and this will be minus 2 times this thing. So basically this entire thing is called the scattering matrix. So scattering matrix, one compact way of writing scattering matrix is also given for a n cross n system, will be given by z matrix, impedance matrix which is also n cross n matrix, I am not writing it though, y matrix y inverse plus I z into y inverse plus, I am sorry, minus I is equal to I times minus 2 z y inverse and plus I. Okay. So you will get, you know, this sort of a thing. So this is your S matrix. Basically scattering matrix relates the waves that are reflected from the ports to the incident wave. So now we might be asking why are we doing this. So we can, you know, we can have any sort of, this is a very powerful representation. You would realize the importance of this thing by actually considering n plus m system where you can have n inputs and m outputs. So n can be any number, it can, you can actually instead of n, you know, instead of n you can put it n plus m. So you can restructure the matrix by putting the first n rows can be your n inlets and m can be outlets. Of course in you know, in conventionally you would analyze a single inlet and single outlet system, but typically, you know, the photographs of lot of commercial vehicles, if you see on the internet or, you know, if you go around and have a look at the muffler photographs, you see double outlet mufflers as well. So you know, basically what happens is that the analysis of such a system, you know, B1, B2, B3, where B1 is the inlet port and S2 and 2 and 3 are the outlet ports. So S11, S12, S13, S21, S31, S33. This will be your scattering matrix for a single inlet and a double outlet system. You know, when you talk about, you know, characterizing a system, you know, you can have actually an n inlet and m outlet. So the first chunk will become inlet ports, reflected waves at the inlet ports, and the other chunk will become you know, reflected waves at the outlet ports, which you you know, which you intend to find out. Now let us first you know, analyze a single inlet and single outlet system in terms of scattering matrix. Impedance matrix we will you know, be characterizing a single inlet and multiple outlet, a single inlet and single outlet, rectangular chambers or circular chambers in terms of circular functions or Bessel functions, whatever the case may be. But we will also analyze a muffler with three ports. So one of the ports can be an inlet port, the other two can be outlet ports, and we can optimally, you know, choose the sort of location of such ports to make things you know, quite interesting for us. So in terms of how do you obtain the broadband transmission loss, so you know, you have this B1 B2 is equal to S11 S12 S21 S22 times A1 A2. Okay. Now if you set your let's say you have a system like this, okay, incident wave A1, and so all here one thing that I kind of forgot to mention, I should have mentioned, apologies for that, velocities, the direction of velocity is considered positive looking into the system. So what it means for us, it has a great significance is that, you know, when you consider a system like this, A1 is the incident wave here, And A2 is the incident wave here, and the one that goes, this is B1, this is B2. And you know, direction of mass velocity is considered positive into the system, V1, V2. So, you know, V1 is equal to S11 times A1 and S12 times A2. So, if we set the incident wave to be 0, at the inlet. So, we get A2, if we set A2 0, basically no incident disturbance is there on the boundary. So, we get B1 is equal to S11 times A1 and B2 is equal to S21 times A1 because A2 is 0. What it means is that we are, you know, we are basically by putting, by exciting the system, let us say the this muffler proper single, this is the inlet port. This is the outlet port. So, you know, we are connecting the inlet to the, we are connecting the inlet to the engine, to the engine exhaust, and this is the tailpipe. So, there are no reflections. If we have an anechoic termination, okay, if we have an anechoic termination, what we will get is that A2 will be 0. There will be no incident wave or very negligible for the frequencies of interest, and there will be only B2 waves that are reflected downstream. Okay, so B2 which will be of great interest to us because that will determine the amount of acoustic power carried into the anechoic termination, and A2 is 0 because of anechoic termination, and here you will have non-zero B1 of course. So, exactly these are exactly what you would do when you obtain the transfer matrix, characterize the system in terms of transfer matrix parameters and find out A1, B1 and all that. But here we are moving towards a very general kind of system. So, B1. So, I will get rid of this part and we will just represent B1 reflected wave at the inlet port and reflected wave outlet port in terms of these S11, S21. So, what is the transmission loss then? You know, the transmission loss is defined as 10 times obviously log to the base 10 of the acoustic power incident to the acoustic power transmitted in an anechoic termination. So, here one thing that is very important, I am saying this thing, repeating this thing again and again, is that A2 must be 0, then only this thing will work, and that means the implication, that implies the implication, or that implies the presence of an anechoic termination. So, what is the acoustic power in terms of these things? Let me go to another slide. So, B1 mod B1 square divided by 2 rho naught Y1 is W incident, okay, and mod B2, I am sorry, this is the wave, I am sorry, my mistake, this is the acoustic power that is being carried away back into this direction. So, this is of less importance, the acoustic power that is incident, that is given by this thing, okay. The one that is carried away in the anechoic termination is this thing Y1 and Y2, they can be different in general. So, 10 times log 10 So, let us do some cancellation, and you know, A1 is obviously we know, B2 we could write it in terms of S21. Okay. And of course, we will have Y2 on the top and Y1 in the denominator. So, transmission loss TL is 10 times log 10 by Y2 by Y1 S21 mod square. Okay. We get that. So, entire thing, remember, we got the same thing in terms of your T matrix parameter. Apologies, I am getting something wrong. It is probably something like Y2 plus T22 Y2 by Y1, something like this, was not it? So, this is the counterpart, and when you establish, when you represent S21, you know, once you use, you know, I leave this as an exercise, you must do that, and we will discuss all the implications of this, is that when you sort of figure out that this is a scattering matrix for a two port system, it looks like this, and then once you find out what S21 is in terms of what S21 is in terms of the impedance matrix parameter, you will realize that the transmission loss can be very nicely, you know, expressed in the following form, that TL is equal to 10 times log 10 and 1 by 4 y1 y2. This you can sort of ignore for now, but z11 times y1, z22 times y2, z12, z21 by z21 mod square. So, you know, you will get this. So, let us also, you know, quickly analyze what does it mean. So, clearly, you know, different conditions under which we will get attenuation peaks, conditions under which we get attenuation peaks or trough. Okay. So, when Z11 is going to infinity, Z11 is tending to infinity, and Z21 and Z12, generally it is seen that Z12 is equal to Z21. Why? Because of acoustic reciprocity. Remember our discussions long time back in, I think, in week 10. So, you know, if you excite the system at one port and measure the response at other port, keep the things aside and do the reverse, you will see the same thing. So, this follows from acoustic reciprocity, that which basically says that if the source and receiver positions are changed, then the response does not change. Well, this is true when you do not have a mean flow in general, okay, but otherwise you will have things Z22, Z21, Z12, all right. Now, all these things are finite and Z11 is going to infinity, then it is easy to see, you will see that the log of the argument is going to infinity, so you must be getting an attenuation peak, okay. Other condition, of course, Z22 is going to infinity and Z11, Z12, Z21 all are finite, okay. And what is the other condition that you must have, that where you have your attenuation peak? So, the other condition is that when Z11 and Z22, Z11 and Z22 both are tending to infinity, but Z21 and Z12 are finite. Such a case is a little rare, but it does happen. This can actually happen very frequently by just, you know, optimally locating a certain port, so that, you know, certain mode is excited by one port, but other port does not excite that particular mode. For example, in a concentric circular duct, if you have a port like this, you know, one port center, one port offset. So, here due to this port, as we can see, radial modes will be excited apart from the plane wave, circumferential modes will not be excited. And due to this port 2, you will have your all the modes, azimuthal modes, I mean basically your circumferential modes and radial modes all will be excited. So, basically at the cut-on frequencies of the 1,0, 2,0 and N0 mode, you know, Z22 will go tend to infinity, Z11 will be finite. But for radial mode special case, if you offset it at a certain distance, say that this is on the nodal circle of the 0,1 mode, radial mode, then at 0,1 mode resonance frequency, Z22 will be finite and Z11 will tend to infinity. So, you can get an attenuation peak even at the radial, at the resonance frequency of the 0,1 mode by centering the port 2 at the radial, at the nodal circle. We'll have a look at all these beautiful results when we talk about the three-dimensional analysis. So, that is one thing, and now Z11 and Z22 both tending to infinity, Z21 and Z12 remaining finite, that will also give you a peak. Another peak that is obviously evident when Z21 tends to 0 and Z12 will also tend to 0 because of reciprocity. But Z11 and Z22, they can be finite or they can be infinite regardless of the magnitude. If Z22 tends to infinity, tends to 0, Z21 tends to 0 at a particular frequency, you will still get an attenuation peak. On the one condition for getting a trough is that when all the parameters, you know, Z11, you get troughs number of times. So Z11, Z22 and Z12, Z21, they are all tending to infinity, and they are tending to infinity at the same rate. Then what happens that the numerator of this thing can be very nicely written as, you know, Z11, you know, let me go to this thing, Z11, Z22, okay, and Y2, Y1 into Z22. So these can be neglected because probably not at this stage. So I'll still write it down here, plus Z11, Y2, Z22, Y1, plus Y1, Y2, okay, sorry for that, and minus Z21, minus Z12. So when under the condition when you have your this term tending to infinity, you can sort of clearly ignore the Y1, Y2, which will be much smaller, okay. And if the these things, they go to infinity at the same rate, each of the parameters, then Z11, Z22, they are all, you know, for a reciprocal and a conservative system, they are all purely imaginary. So when they are all tending to infinity at the same rate, then what will happen is basically, you know, this guy can be sort of ignored, or probably they cancel out, and you get Z11, Y2, and Z1, Z22, Y1. Z21, okay, and this is 1 by 4 times Y1, Y2, log of this. So basically when Y1 and Y2, they are all same, you know, when Y1 and Y2, they are all same, they are equal, you can sort of take this out, and you can, probably since they are all tending to infinity, what will happen is that, you know, this can basically be approximately written as 10 times log 10 by Y2 by Y1 and 4, this is square of course, so 4 Y1 Y2 square. So then, you know, when Y1 and Y2 are the same, then you can clearly show that this is equal to 0. So basically these are the conditions under which you will get trough in the attenuation graph. Now there is another thing that I want to talk about is that, you know, systems when you have double outlet, you have your you know, B2, the transmission loss is given for such a system as single inlet and double outlet as 10 times log 10, and you have your A1 mod square by 2 rho naught Y1 like this, and then you have B2, you can write this in terms of you know, S1, so 1 by Y1 and S2 1 mod square by Y2 and S3 1 mod square by Y3. So you know, then you can basically, this is the transmission loss TL1, I'll say, because 1 is the inlet. So you know, by doing these manipulations, you can get a transmission loss for making the port 2 as the inlet and ports 1 and 3 as the are the outlet ports, and so on. So in general, you can find out a transmission loss for a single inlet and multiple outlet system, you know, by these scattering matrix expression, and trust me, these S matrix parameters get very nasty once you increase the number of ports. So I would just evaluate them numerically rather than finding out conditions under which you're getting peaks or attenuation troughs and all that. So, you know, with this discussion, I'll, you know, close off the lecture 1 of week 11. When we meet tomorrow for lecture 2 and possibly combined lectures 2 and 3 of week 1, we'll analyze a rectangular chamber using different methodologies like, you know, homogeneous system equations subjected to inhomogeneous boundary conditions, or inhomogeneous equation subjected to homogeneous boundary condition, that is your Green's function approach or a uniform piston driven approach. One of them we'll follow, and try to figure out some transmission loss parameters of certain configurations. Lectures 4 and 5 will be on circular chambers, and let's see how far we can progress with these sort of things. There are quite a few things to cover. So with this, I'll end the lecture for today, and I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks.